church say amen.
Amen.
Actually, I have definitely the honor and privilege that pastors have gave me the opportunity to expound upon God's word.
Right.
You know, definitely I do have passion for that. And one thing that's really so encouraging is that I have such a great support staff here at New Horizon.
Amen.
Especially a pastor that loves and has compassion. And then also has a relationship, a standing relationship with the Lord. It's not anything that he can even disguise. It just sticks out there right in front. One thing also I'd like to thank those that are very special to me, that always give me that word of encouragement. You know, actually, I've had so many strong mentorships, and I can't say enough that I know it's nothing but the Lord giving me the positive role models in my life, and which again makes me just want to go that extra mile. One thing that's really so nice is I'm getting a little bit better with my. Like Pastor David says, his gizmo. But the iPad and me have came a long way in fighting viciously. But I think I finally conquered the fight. But as anyone knows about me, whenever the Lord brings a message to me, I'm actually preaching to myself. And I always have my back. So even if the gizmo don't work out correctly for me, we will keep moving on, giving God the praise and the glory. Also, again, my personal family, thank you. My wife, I give her my nickname as Black Eyed Peas. Everybody always says their favorite name.
Yes, yes.
Prime rib or, you know, a steak or something, but everybody knows I got a weakness for Black Eyed Peas.
I know that.
And you can call me Corn.
Yeah.
So without any further ado, I'd like to go to the Lord in prayer. Let us bow. My most gracious, loving Heavenly Father, hallelujah to you in the eyes. Thank you, Father, for just giving us the opportunity that we can all kneel at your feet, your throne of mercy, to give you the thanks and the praise for bringing us here right now, blessing us more than what we can even keep track of. Father, touch the hearts that they will be marinated. Remove anything from me that would be a hindrance in sharing exactly what you have prepared for me to share. Heavenly Father, we just want to give you the glory and give you the praise. And this we ask in the precious, priceless name of Jesus. And all those that love him will say,
amen.
Amen.
Well, I'd like to actually start. I've had so many strong mentors in my life. But if you can, repeat after me.
All scripture
is given by inspiration of God. And profitable for doctrine. For reproof. For correction. For instructions in righteousness. That the man of God may be perfect. Thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Now, if I would have to title this particular message that the Lord's been tugging with me all week, and please believe me, again, I can't stress it enough, I preach also to myself as well. There are some things that, as you see throughout this quick, brief sermon, that I will actually make some confessions right in front of you, which definitely may be wrong with it. There would be a title with this sermon would call, Losing My Religion and gaining God's.
Amen.
Our religion can often look like nothing how the Lord had planned for us to have it. God set us up to fellowship with him. Our religion should be a personal relationship with God at all times. Can I get rid of a few things that maybe someone might not even know? Brother Jackson's still under construction.
Amen.
You know, definitely I fall down, I get up. I guess maybe I might be the only one of the world that have that particular problem. But I am under construction. So sometimes maybe I might end up saying something that might be worldly.
please forgive me. Bring it to my attention, because I have thick skin as well. You know, because I don't want to lose my religion. I want to keep gaining God's.
Amen.
Now, I know that there's a handout that some have out there that, you know, it's going to be pretty easy to follow along, because my message that the Lord gave me ties right into that handout. And it's very simple. There are a few things that the Holy Spirit definitely would like for me to get, and also for you to get as well. Now, I feel that if anybody knows my preaching style, you're going to need a piece of paper and pencil. You have the paper already. If you don't have a pencil, just try to remember the scripture, because it actually speaks. The Holy Spirit will speak to you so you can get these answers. There's probably only one that you will not find in the Bible, and we'll go over that very slowly. Now, the actual scripture that I'm going to be coming out of, and if you don't mind standing, is in James chapter 1, verse 26 and 27. I'm reading out of the old King James version. So, there again, I've learned in the past not to have the congregation read, because I believe I found out this morning there's 130-something different English versions of the Bible.
Yeah.
And I'm sure there's probably 50 of them in here that are different. But in the old King James, it reads says, if a man ducks, if a man among you, that's chapter 1, James chapter 1, verses 26 and 27.
Amen.
It's really actually on your handout. If a man among you seems to be righteous and writeth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this: to visit the fatherless, the widows, in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. From the world, you may be seated in the presence of the Lord. But really, actually, the two verses that we read are very, very strong and full of a lot of nuggets. I just gleaned a few of them, because there would be a good word study with this actual two verses. Now, if you can't do me a favor, I want you to know that this week, everyone has homework. You can see that it's packed, probably more likely printed on your sheet. Please repeat this after me. I have homework.
I have homework.
Okay, that's going to be really beneficial for you, simply because that when you have something to do according to what God's Word said, it's only going to make you stronger. It's going to be able to help you with some things that more likely you might even be going through right now in your life. Now, again, the homework would be the assignment of reading half of chapter 1 in James, verse 19 all the way through 27. But if you want to be one of those A scholars, I would say go all the way from the beginning to the end of that chapter. That would be proper and fitting. But again, you have homework. Now let's get right into this word, because definitely I don't want to belabor you, because we have a saying here at New Horizon: get to the point and not keep you long. Give God the praise and everybody will be happy. Now, again, looking at verse 26, it says, if a man among you seem to be righteous and bridle not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. Now, James is giving a firm warning to teachers and to ministers and to Christians. Now, you know that maybe this might be something that you just never even thought about, but every Christian has a ministry. Now, how many Christians do we have in this room? Just show me about your hand. Don't be afraid to raise your hand just because I see every Christian has a ministry. Because definitely you do. You're responsible for that ministry. Whether it's in work, circular, whether it's work in the church, whether it's in your family, you have a ministry that you are responsible for to show
the light of Jesus Christ. Everything. And it's a personal relationship that you have to go with every day. When we realize that we fall short, we have to, again, get back up and stand up and let the Lord use us again. He helps you actually really get back up. Now, first thing I'd like to share with you is that the word of the Lord is so very important. We all have a religion. But we all that are Christians should be religious. Now, being religious is definitely a reflection of your religion. Now, hopefully I'm not playing on words to get a little bit confusing out there, but if you are a Christian, you are religious because you're holding Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, and you have a religion in Jesus Christ. It's really pretty simple once you just put the A, B, C's together. Religious, religion. Now, there are some, and I can actually raise my hand, that we do have other religions that get in the way, that complement our actions, our behavior, that we need to keep address of the true religion, a righteous religion, one that is personal. Now, my religion is personal and a personal relationship that I have with Jesus Christ. Now, again, if we do not keep in focus, guess who gets the victory? Nobody but the devil. Because we're again putting again our own religion, superseding God, what he has planned for us through his word, and throwing it away. Our religion often has a tendency. I'm going to get better with my gizmo. Still have a good one. Our religion is a full-time relationship that God sets up for us. Now, a full-time religion should always express what we need to show. But there again, we have to remember to watch our thoughts, because our thoughts become our words. We have to try to watch our words, because our words become our deeds. We have to watch our deeds, because our deeds become our habits. And we have to watch our habits, because our habits become our character. That's one thing that really gets away from all of us. We wind up getting inundated with this crazy world out there, TV, what's going on in our lives, our children's lives, our spouse's lives, our best friend's lives, and we forget to use our thoughts. Our thoughts should, again, be directed toward our religion, our relationship, our personal relationship with our Lord and Savior. If we miss that, we're missing out on such a great opportunity. Now, there's a few things that we need to make sure that we keep address. In James chapter 1, verse 26, it talks about far as bridling the tongue. So profound. You know, one thing that's really so sad is when we don't bridle the tongue, again, we're controlling our own religion. We have no idea about far as where and what God's word is saying. We've already superseded. We've already wound up letting our character, our habits, our deeds, our words, our thoughts supersede what God has asked and placed for us. Controlling that tongue is so very vital to keep a tight rein. That's what basically bridle means. Hold on to it. Now, I would like to discuss a little bit of holding on to the reins of our itty-bitty tongue in our mouth, because it does so much damage. It is four things that I want to capitalize so that when you realize that maybe, wow, I did that, or I do that, you can wind up regaining back your composure, getting back off the ground, then asking God to help you and move forward. The first thing I would like to share is what that little bitty tongue does. You know, I like the way how my brother speaks about it because he's tight tongue. And he said, that little bitty tongue. But no matter how it's said, it actually speaks volume. No matter if you're tight-tongued, even if you stutter, it will still be the same effect. The first one I'd like to touch bases on that it does is lying. Well, I guess maybe I'm maybe going to have to because everybody looks like they never have ever told me. It's really sad because, you know, a lot of times we like to categorize our lies. A little white lie. Uh-huh. Or this lie won't hurt nobody. Uh-huh. Or this is one that I'm going to lie about that I can get out of trouble. I guess I'm the only one that's doing that gospel. Because when I do that, I realize that I just fell down. Mm-hmm. It doesn't take a juror. It doesn't take someone to say that I lied. That little subconscious that God has given each and every one of us, it tells you yourself. You know that ain't the truth. You know something deep down in your heart. Because, again, you have religion. You have a relationship, a personal relationship with the Lord, hopefully. Now, we do have some of those that will profess to have a personal relationship, but they don't. That little second thing is, and I know that definitely, I've conquered this. Maybe someone's out there struggling, cursing. Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
You know, when you hear someone curse and it catches you off guard, you wind up saying, that person is so much more intelligent than that. Why in the world are they using that kind of language? I wound up realizing that, first of all, a black person, us folks, don't even have to say a word. We can walk in a room and we are intimidating. I don't know why. Maybe it's the presence of what the Lord has given us to use and do His work for the relationship and the religion that we all have. We can walk in the room and command respect. Or they got their eyes on us for some reason.
All right.
Now, the third one is swearing. Some people that I know, you can't trust them even if their tongue was notarized.
Well,
it's just every word come out of their mouth. You have to say, wow, that do sound good. But I know that's a lie. Yeah. I was there. Or I know that's a lie because I can't believe a word out of their mouth. Isn't that sad when you can't believe a word out of someone's mouth? It's just a sad scenario of their relationship, their personal relationship with the Lord, their religion. Also, now, the other one, I have to do some word search and word crossword. And actually, it's one that maybe some of the old timers that know about, but it's called Ribaldry. And we've seen it, though. They even have a problem with it in schools today. It's called bullying. It's called actually saying nasty and derogatory things to people. Not cursing, not lying, but just bullying. Just trying to be a tyrant in what you say and how you act and what's coming out of your mouth. No words of edification for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The power of our tongue is endless. There's a lot of other things that this little splitty bitty teeny muscle do that we could talk about all day. I'm sure each and every one of us have some exposure and some experience with that.
Yeah.
With that. Bullying, and I guess really none of us, especially in this room, like you see, don't like bullies. Filthy language sometimes. Now, 27, capsulizing that. And I'm going to be with you just a few, 3 minutes more because it's not going to take much long as 26. At 27, it says, pure religion and undefiled before God
and the Father is this. First of all, look at what that just says. That actually gives us confirmation on how we're baptized. Because we know we have the Holy Spirit, but we know we are baptized with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. This is one of the only times that I've really, there's a few other times in the Bible that capitalizes this, but it points out definitely to God the Son and God the Father. It points it crystal clear. If you can read the King's language, you know that this is talking about our Heavenly Father, Jesus, and also His Heavenly Father, our Heavenly Father, God the Father. To comprehend that, that capitalizes the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is giving us clear, clean interpretation right now of what that word and what His word is saying. Now, to be to visit the fatherless, the widows. Now see, technically speaking, back in biblical days, it was almost sentenced to that. When you were a widow, or if you had no father, you had no source of income. You were out there, you were destitute. We have that same problem today. You know, there can be someone doing so well, and then the financial structure of a parent collapse. Or has gone home to be with glory. Gone home to be with the Lord. And that surviving spouse, that surviving child is in destitute. But you know what? God's religion has set up something for us already. Actually, to capitalize verse 27, He's asking us to make sure that we still use benevolence.
Yeah.
The church has the power. We don't have to turn to the Donald Trumps. We don't have to turn to the government of the United States. I mean, of the governor of California. The church has the power.
Amen.
It was in my day when the church said something, that was almost pure gospel. You know, and actually, really, the only way that we're supposed to be under compliance with our government, but the only time when we can jump ship is when they contradict what God's word says. When we actually know that it's wrong to do something that our government or our law officials or something along that line is asking us to do. We have no penalization, no not sense to doing the wrong thing. But when we stand upon God's true and never unchanging word, we can stand firm. Now, again, I have to make a confession because I was just looking at it this morning. I used to always try to give something to benevolence on my envelope, my church envelope, because it stuck out there, benevolence, it's just like that person sticking in your mouth, in your ear, saying, hey, you gotta do this, you gotta do this. But you know, we have a little bit more of a growth period, and I think that if I'm falling into that same stumbling block, some of the others that visit our church and that actually our membership don't see benevolence. And we're not asking for you to, you know, how so many church members, well, I just come up $2 or $5 of my offering, put that on benevolence, but I'm still giving that sacred $5 or whatever amount, not taking that lightly. But I found out that I can't outgive God.
Amen.
I do. There's no way in the world. Every morning He shows me His grace and His glory. Every day He shows me that He's with me by my side. He provides barriers, protections, hedges that I can't even see. He provides the substance that I can see. One of the things that each and every one of our prayers we should hold into is saying, thank you for the things that I see, and thank you for the things I don't see.
That's
because
right.
He has never stopped working for you. He's a 724
right.
God. He has never leave you or forsake you.
Right.
He's a good God.
Yeah. Yeah.
If we wind up not doing the best that we can, He can't give us the best.
All right.
How many of you had those parents that, you know, if you didn't do your chores, if you didn't do the things that was actually
expected of him.
Yeah.
It was going to be a hard road to pull.
That's right.
It was going to be something that we have actually got away from with our children. We have a tendency to let them hang on into the iPhone. And they feel that they have a right when you want to take it from them. They have to do something constructive. So if the last thing you get out of version 27 is give it to those that are in need. Now, I have a pretty good idea when it comes out, I see someone at the store, see someone on the side of the freeway. You know, I'm generous. But there again, your ministry always starts first. I didn't put this question on your handout, but where did your ministry first start? At home.
Amen.
At home.
Amen.
If I didn't have my ministry at home, I'd probably have to be asking for somebody to sleep on this sofa. Because my first ministry, I know that God gave me responsibility for, is at home.
Amen.
That's with my wife, my children.
Yeah.
But first of all, to God.
Yes.
Now, in a few minutes, I'm going to give you a chance to accept the great invitation that our pastor shared in the very first part before I got up here. And if there's some that are in even a limbo, a halfway mark of not knowing where their salvation is, or where they're going to serve, or who they're going to call pastor. Because really, we all should have a person we call pastor. Even he has a pastor. Even the minister that I know, that I fellowship with, that had shepherdship, they had pastors. Even when I had a brief moment, I had pastors. I had more than one. Pastor Johnson was one of them. But there again, if you don't have a chance to know and have someone with the shepherdship that can kind of give you the direction of where you need to go, you'll be able to extend the hand of faith to you in a few minutes. But my prayer is to that we do our homework, stay in the Lord, and give him the praise. God bless you.
Amen. Amen.